to you, his messages to you, his miraculous signs to you, so you can now become committed to guidance. Now become serious. This was step two. Step two was hold on to the Quran and use that as an excuse to create brotherhood. Use as an excuse to create unity. You know what we're seeing here tonight? This is not Nouman Ali Khan, this is the power of Quran. This is Quran, it can create unity. We don't even know each other. But I sense a genuine brotherhood. You feel it too. This is powerful. This is what Quran can do. So you can become committed to God, you can feed off of each other's energy, and you can become more and more serious, and more committed to the direction that Allah wants you to go into. The final step, if we get through this step, and we have a healthy community, and we have brotherhood among each other, then we are ready for the next step. You don't go to the next step until you take care of step one and step two. Eventually we'll be at step three. What's step three? وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ. Out of you, a group should rise. They should be made up of people from you. And their job will be to call people to good things. They'll be always inviting people to good things. In other words, not every one of us is going to hit the podium. But there will be a group that will come from us. When the brotherhood is created, talents will be identified, and we're going to hone those talents, and the entire community is going to invest in those talents, and they're going to rise. And they're going to call people to good. وَيَأْمُرُونَ. Can you imagine young people from our community, our own community, one day giving the khutbas, one day inviting people to good, one day going and going on talk shows and responding to people that are hating on Islam? Our own kids that are born and raised here, can you imagine that day? It's an incredible thing. When they're from among you, calling to the good. يَدْعُونَ لِلْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Probably one of the most misunderstood concepts in the entire Quran. Actually, I was going to spend about an hour and a half just on this tonight, but I can't. Just on وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. But I'll summarize what I can for you. The translation says most of the time, they command the good and forbid the evil. How many people have heard that before? Command the good, forbid the evil, right? You've heard that before, right? Very, very shallow translation. Ya'murun means it's a spectrum of things. Amr means suggesting something, advising something, trying to convince someone to do something, you know, encouraging someone to do something, and commanding someone to do something. Is there a difference between suggesting and encouraging and commanding? There is, right? It starts with suggestion. And you know there are different situations. I'll give you a real life, really simple example. I love simple examples. Or I think they're simple. Right? Dinner's ready. I'm going to call my dad to dinner, and I'm going to call my son to dinner. Dad is downstairs, son is upstairs. I'm going to say to my son, dinner's ready. I'm going to say to my dad, Abba, dinner's ready. I did Amr in both cases. In one case, I used authority. In the other case, I used respect, request, right? Two different things. Two different situations. Amr bil ma'roof depends on the situation. You don't go commanding people. You don't take out your, you know, your haram gun and haram, 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 haram. Like, everything's haram. You can't do that, don't do that, no, no, no. And we have, unfortunately, some of this social constipation in our masajid in some places. But we have it. I know it's a bad term, but I feel that way. Like it's almost like you can't even be happy in a masjid. Like if you smile and say, Assalamu alaikum. Like, masjid. No happiness here. Oh man, masjid is supposed to be a place you can be happy. Don't be judgmental on people. Don't just, you know, tell people, you should be doing this, that's haram, you know, that's not right, you know. And the guy, you know, this happened in a masjid recently. These youth came to the masjid in Ramadan, last Ramadan. And some of these kids have never been in a masjid. Like, they're Muslim, but they've never been in a masjid, ever. The kid walks into the masjid, he's got a couple of earrings, you know. And he's got tattoos. What if some of our incredibly wise members of the community do? That's haram. He's like, what, my ears? Haram? What, do you want to pull it off? You know, then you're going to say it's your salat is not accepted, you're bleeding. What do you want me to do? You can't go around telling people what to do. Your first job is to instill people in awareness of Allah. Everything else will fall into place. Remember step one? So what does Amr bil Ma'ruf really mean? It means call people to good, decent behavior. Encourage people to do the right thing. Don't worry about the finer details. They will happen. They will take care of themselves. Worry about the big things. You know, you can correct someone on how high their pants are, and you can try to advise someone to get out of a liquor store, which is a priority. Think about that. You know, you're correcting someone. No. You need to pray all 20. For 20 tarawih, or don't come at all. Seriously? Okay, alhamdulillah. The situation outside is under control, they're saying. Alright, alhamdulillah. Yeah, we can go on, inshallah. But yeah, we can. Okay, so what was I saying? Something about Islam? Yeah, priorities. Priorities. When you're going to bring up an issue, make sure it's an issue of priority. There are finer details in our deen. Brother, the way you're making wudu is not correct. It may be true, the way he's making wudu is not correct. That's not the way to bring it up though. That's not the way to bring it up. That's not Amr bin Ma'ruf. That's just you trying to show people that you know more than them. That's just you inflating your own ego. Don't do that. And eventually, when we become a community of encouraging each other to do good, and I tell you what that is, I'll give you some practical examples of what you should be encouraging people to do. Tell people, how are you raising your kids? What do you plan on doing with the kids? You know, even for Muslims that aren't practicing their religion, even they're worried about their children, right? Even non-Muslims are worried about their children. And so when we bring that priority, then people actually, that concern for our children is an actual easy vehicle by which people can start coming closer to their religion too. Coming closer to becoming more serious about their deen. يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ They forbid all disgusting, vile things. Before you talk about halal and haram issues, which most of you and I are not qualified to talk about anyway, let's talk about evil things first. Outright evil things. What are evil things? These are things like shamelessness in the media. Shows that make fun of prophets. And our kids watch them. And they have no problem with it. The kind of munkar that's going on nowadays, I feel, is, you know, I don't necessarily come out and say Twitter and Facebook and all that stuff is haram, because I don't think personally, I don't see that it's forbidden. But I do see that Muslims have no standards. We have no standards in how we talk. When somebody says something and you want to put a comment about what they said, most of the time it's a compliment or an insult. You tell me, compliment or insult? Insult. Most of the time you want to say something that puts somebody else down. This is just not how a Muslim talks. We just don't talk like this. That's not how we're supposed to communicate. This is a kind of munkar. You're just creating bad feelings among each other. You're making a culture out of making fun of each other. وَلَا يَسْخَرْ قَوْمٌ مِّن قَوْمٍ Don't let any group make fun of another group. Don't do that. That's just not how you should do. Right? Another munkar is just how much we're allowing our standards to drop in what we watch on TV and what we watch in movies. We allow ourselves to say, it's only PG-13. It's only R, but it's only got one bad scene. Everything else is fine. Did you see the special effects? I mean, who of you is going to go on Judgment Day? You're being interrogated about the movie. I said, did you see the special effects though? It's amazing. Nope. At that point, it's not worth it. Stop making excuses. Stop making excuses. And one of Shaitan's jobs is to make bad deeds no big deal. So when somebody says, you know, that's a really bad idea, the first thing Shaitan will put in your head is, come on man, lighten up. Relax. Everything's haram for you. Live a little. You won't be saying that later on. You'll be saying that now. This is the essential message of Quran. وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَلَى الْمُنْكَرِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ And those are the ones that are truly successful. The rest of my conversation with you guys will be about this ayah. And how we can create a culture around this ayah within the Muslim community, within every single masjid in the country, within Houston, within the city of Houston, inshallah ta'ala. You know? And how we can become a part of that. Of implementing these three steps starting at the masjid. This session I want to conclude with the following statement that will give a rise to the next section, the next conversation I want to have with you as a result of this.